I called the Metallica house and James answered the phone. And I was like, we're in trouble.
Had no clue that, you know, there's another day after ours. You know, another band has to use your trailer.
You're gonna have to go over there and talk to Bill.
I was like, oh shit, like I'm being called in. He sat me down and he said, hey, I know you're a rock and roll band at heart and, you know, breaking shit, destroying things, you know, might be fun for a little bit.
What would you do if people came in your home and behaved this way? And James goes, well, pretty much they do every week. And
I didn't quite get what he was trying to say. And he said, you guys are talented and you're on a path of destruction. He knew. He said, I've had the same talk with Sid Vicious and with Keith Moon, and they didn't listen. Maybe you'll listen, maybe not.
What really happened was James totally manned up and Bill completely respected it.
So I said, you know, I'm young, I'm stupid, and thanks for that. I appreciate the talk and I'll do my best.
Years later, he would go to me, how's James? Well, you know, I haven't really talked to him lately, but I'm sure he's fine.
To this day, I still never said thank you to him because it did enlighten me a little bit.
He made it right to the best of his ability.
The next time we came back to play in the backstage area, he put Visqueen clear plastic over everything. The ceiling, the walls, the floor, the table. He even wrapped bottles of beer in it so it would be protected.
1986 was an ear-shattering year for thrash metal. Metallica, Megadeth, and Slayer, followed by Anthrax, all released landmark albums.
So I was asking Lars where this was taken, and he says, I'm pretty sure it's in Copenhagen.
He would wake up and put on his little boxer shorts, and he had a little amp and his white guitar, and it looked like a Gibson, but it wasn't. And he would play. He could not wait to get on the road. And Cliff was excited. As much as he didn't want to go to Europe, it was a short tour. He wanted me to start looking at houses. At this point, we'd really developed and we were gonna live together. So he wanted me to kind of look at houses just around in the East Bay.
On September 26, 1986, Metallica played a show in Stockholm, Sweden, supported by their friends Anthrax. Anthrax went on ahead to the next show. Metallica never made it. In the early hours of September 27th, their tour bus crashed and Cliff Burton was killed. He was 24 years old.
I went home and started calling Cliff in Sweden at the hotel. I had the itinerary. Oh, no, they haven't checked in yet. Okay, that's weird. Try again an hour later. That's when she told me. And it wasn't even real. It wasn't possible. So I immediately called Cliff's parents. I didn't want to be with anyone else. You know, wanted to be with his parents and smell his things.
We don't sit back and say, oh, I hope we're big next year, or I hope this, I hope that. We just go and do it and don't put a lot of thought into what might happen or what could happen. We try not to think too much about the future.
Cliff was such a character, and he was with us for that short amount of time. Thank God there were some people filming and there were friends around that had cameras. To respect that time greatly, I am so glad that he was in my life and I got to share some times with him.
Someone so close and someone who I saw my future with, and it was awful. It was just awful.
Most of us were so young back then that we really hadn't dealt with death before.
The first thing I did, I got up and I headed out to the vault because I was working the next day at the store. From the minute that we opened the door, it was a constant flood of people coming in. It was the place where people came to grieve. It was the place where people came to reflect and tell stories. And it was almost the perfect place to find out because it was home for all of the scene, also for him and those guys.
What made us survive it was that community of those thrashers.
No one ever thought about the perils of rock and roll or the fact that tour buses crash and, you know, people die out there doing what we were all aspiring to do and doing what he ultimately loved.
I know we felt bad, but I couldn't only imagine what each one of them personally felt. Yeah, it's a terrible time. Terrible thing.
What I know about Cliff was that he was a very gentle soul, and we laughed, and we would laugh.
You can't ask more from your kids, particularly when you don't have to say much to them. Cliff would just decide he knew on his own what was right and what was wrong, and he practiced it just like he practices music.
People forget why you do this. It's because, think back to those days when you guys were in a shitty rehearsal room. Nothing else mattered but just making something. That's all you live for.
So Metal Allegiance, we're just the guys from the neighborhood. We're the friends that all share the same record collection. And it was just a great spirit. And we said, you know, maybe we should make a record to see what it sounds like if all of us can actually write and record some music together.
The marching orders for that record, though, is we're writing a thrash metal record. And obviously Alex is involved with that scene. We're getting Mark Acevedo, Gary Holt, and Chuck Billy. We're getting the Bay Area's best.
You would hope this happens everywhere. But we're like, you know, do you think it does? Like, no, it's the Bay Area. No, it's a special place. And we got some special people that are backing each other. To do any jams with people, you know? And I got approached, I'm like, absolutely, please. Pledging your allegiance, look me in the face. Walking through flooded gates, show your true disgrace. Messaging a smile, going through big lanes. Covering that broken fear, I can think straight. Walking dead straight. Drowning in your fear. Save your life. You can't do. Pledge your allegiance. Fighting is on you. Pledge your allegiance. Go!
Since the 1980s, thrash metal music that was nurtured in the Bay Area extended its reach around the globe, inspiring metal fans everywhere to crank it up. In 2013, Gary Holt replaced the late, great Jeff Hanneman in Slayer.
It's kind of weird, you know? It's like I got the call from Carrie to help them out, you know? People who don't know the background between the two bands will ask me, wow, how's it feel to be playing with such metal legends? They're my buddies.
I think metal fans are the most devoted of any fans there are. They're not fickle. They like what they like. And I think Slayer fan is that fan times 10.
To me, it's about humility. And I'm more humbled by the fact that people have such an admiration for the band. You hear stories about some of these people that your music made me strong and held me together to get past a certain point in my life. I'm very grateful for that. You get me all teary-eyed.
In 2017, Megadeth won the Grammy for Best Metal Performance for their album, Dystopia.
One thing is for sure, this community has a way of taking care of its own. I'm honored that the fans still like what we're doing. It's great to hear. Feels good.
Yo sabía que la mejor audiencia para Metallica es la mexicana, aquí en México. Y más los chilangos. ¡Woo!
Oh, my God! Woo! Like wrestlers.
The wrestlers.
When we put out our instruments, we're like teenagers again. We have a good time, we joke around, we laugh. Everything we do revolves around the jam. There seems to be a certain energy and magic that's very pure about this music.
In 2016, Metallica released Hardwired to Self-Destruct to massive critical and commercial acclaim.
We are super grateful to still be where we are. You know, we're in Mexico City right here playing in front of 60 to 70,000 people. In one show, it blows my mind. It's pretty remarkable for bands like Megadeth and Anthrax and Slayer and Exodus still around and still playing gigs. I tell you, whatever you think is gonna happen to you, you have no freaking idea. You just don't.
If it wasn't for Cliff, if it wasn't for, you know, those early Metallica records, you know, I would not be there, that's for sure. And there would be no Metal Allegiance.
Cliff was a fun bass player. And you can feel that on stage. For me, I'm honored and blessed to be able to play his bass lines and celebrate him and his bass playing to the world, all over the world, to take it there and share it.
We're sitting in 1982 having a conversation about the East Bay days. Obviously, nobody at that time would ever slow down long enough to believe that the music could have and the scene could have that kind of impact and that kind of longevity.
There's a shirt that says, I think, for albums and still no ballad. And they meant that because they weren't about that. You know, they weren't going to do it.
I love those guys. They're still my friends. They're like my brothers.
We didn't invent music, we didn't invent metal. We just took what we loved, you know, and we stood on the backs of giants and put our own two cents in, that's all we did. And out came thrash metal.
It was a real happening that had real far-reaching impact over music culture over time.
See, this wasn't here. I wonder if the stage was kind of where the bathroom was.
I think it was, and this wall was exposed. Mm-hmm. You know, we're talking like, you know, 35 years ago and shit,
yeah,
so
exactly.
More or more.
I'm surprised how nice the park looks, though. It's pretty awesome.
We did a lot of cover tunes. We did Get Your Rocks Off by Def Leppard and Wasted by Def Leppard. And
Half the first Maiden album, you know.
Our friend bought Iron Maiden 1 just because of the cover and, like, it was so fresh and new back then. A lot of people thought Running Free was an Exodus original for a little while. And we're like, no, sorry, can't take credit for that one.
Yeah, Prowler, all that. Like, I love that song, Prowler.
And Kirk used to sing Another Piece of Meat by the Scorpions.
That was in my high school band room back when I still went to school.
It was a perfect storm of all the people that we needed to form a long-lasting musical scene that went on to do great things. And the amazing thing about it is we were all young, innocent, and didn't know what the fuck we were doing or where it all was going. It just happened. It was like from heaven. It was one of the greatest times of my life.
You know, I was telling somebody this morning that I thought Metallica played here.
No, Kirk Hammett from Metallica, when he was a member of our band Exodus, we played here when we were 16
years
old.
No, you guys are Exodus.
Yeah.
I've been a fan forever. That is so awesome. You're back.
Exodus continue to play on around the world, and still, no fucking ballads.